Let's look at how air density affects the wings and propeller of an aircraft. First, a propeller is like a wing that acts vertically rather than horizontally. Both have airfoil shapes, but the wing is used to support the weight of the airplane and generate lift, whereas the propeller is used to propel or pull the airplane forward through the air. The four forces of flight are lift, thrust, weight, and drag. When lift is equal to weight and thrust is equal to drag, the aircraft is said to be in equilibrium, meaning that it is not climbing or descending, nor is it accelerating or decelerating. If one of these forces exceeds the other, the aircraft moves in the direction of the greater force. For example, if there is more lift than weight, then the airplane climbs. In this lesson, we are primarily interested in the relationship between lift and weight. In order for an airplane to become airborne, it must generate enough lift to overcome the weight of the airplane. The weight includes the mass of the airplane, plus everything in it, such as fuel, the pilot and passengers, and any cargo or luggage. To determine how much lift is produced, there is a mathematical formula called the lift equation, which states that the amount of lift produced is equal to the coefficient of lift, or CL, times the density, represented by the Greek letter rho, times the velocity squared, times the surface area of the wing, or S, all divided by 2. The coefficient of lift, shown as CL, is determined by wind tunnel testing of the wing airfoil at a given angle of attack. As the angle of attack increases, so does the coefficient of lift up to a point, and then it decreases with an increase in angle of attack. The maximum coefficient of lift takes place at the peak of the chart, which is also known as the critical angle of attack. Any angle of attack to the left of the critical angle of attack has a positive coefficient of lift. Any angle of attack to the right of the critical angle of attack results in a stall. In flight, the pilot controls the angle of attack of the wing by manipulating the elevator of the airplane to change the pitch about the lateral axis. The surface area of the wing, shown as S, is found by multiplying the wingspan times the wing chord. The surface area of the wing is set by the designer and generally is a fixed value. Adding lift-generating devices, such as flaps or slats, increases the wing area. The density of air is represented by the Greek letter rho. When pilots state that their airplane's climb performance is more effective in the winter or more difficult in the summer, it is actually related to air density more than temperature. During the winter, the air tends to be very dense, suggesting a larger number for density in the lift equation, thus resulting in more lift. The opposite is true for hot summer days, where air density is low, suggesting a smaller number for density in the lift equation, thus resulting in little lift. The velocity of the airplane is the speed at which it is moving through the air. The velocity of the aircraft is a variable that the pilot can change in flight that has the greatest effect on the lift equation because the velocity is squared. If the coefficient of lift, density, and surface area of the wing are held constant, and the velocity is increased, lift increases and the airplane climbs. This is the reason pilots have to add nose-down trim to the airplane after accelerating to a faster speed, because the wing is now generating more lift than before. Bernoulli's equation has long been used to explain what happens to air passing over the curved top surface of an airplane wing. It states that as the wing moves through the air, the flow of air hits the leading edge of the wing where it splits and travels either over the top or under the bottom of the wing. Regardless of its path, it has to arrive at the trailing edge of the wing at the same time. Air must travel a further distance across the top of the wing than for the bottom of the wing due to the shape of the airfoil. In order for air over the top of the wing to travel a further distance, yet arrive at the same point as air moving a shorter distance under the wing, the air over the top of the wing must travel at a higher velocity than the bottom. This higher velocity air moving over the curved top surface creates a drop in pressure or a low pressure area that sucks the wing upward. Bernoulli's equation considers only the relationship between velocity and atmospheric pressure above and below the wing. The lift equation determines the actual amount of lift generated by the wing. We can observe the relationship between the different variables of the lift equation if we consider the same airplane traveling in level flight at 90 knots and compare air flowing over the wing at sea level and at 6,000 feet. The amount of lift required at both altitudes, the wing area and the angle of attack, are considered to be the same in both cases. Only the density and velocity are factors that vary. From the graphic, we can see that the density of air at 6,000 feet is less than at sea level. The amount of lift required is a fixed amount since the weight of the airplane is the same regardless of altitude. So, if the density becomes a lower value, the velocity becomes larger or increases to make up the difference. To demonstrate this, consider an airplane taking off from a runway at sea level and at an altitude of 6,000 feet. In both cases, the wings must generate enough lift to overcome the weight of the airplane. At 6,000 feet, the density is less than at sea level. If we tried to take off at the same velocity as at sea level, the wing would not produce enough lift to allow the airplane to leave the ground. Therefore, at 6,000 feet, the aircraft must accelerate to a higher velocity to counter the loss in density altitude in order to produce the amount of lift required to fly. This increase in velocity creates other risks, such as requiring more time to get up to speed, using more runway, lowering the rate of climb, and causing the visual illusion of faster speed called ground rush. During takeoff and landing at higher elevations or airports with a high density altitude, the higher true airspeed creates the illusion that you are going faster over the ground. On takeoff, pilots may rotate early because the speed of things passing by outside looks fast enough to what they are used to encountering, but the airspeed indicator shows a slower speed than what is being perceived by the eyes. At landing, pilots may chop the throttle, believing they are going too fast based on what their eyes see, despite the correct speed being shown on the airspeed indicator, inadvertently stalling the airplane due to the loss of lift. Flying by feel or by how things look may lead a pilot to trouble. Pilots must be aware of visual illusions caused by high elevation or high density altitude airports, and remember to use the same airspeeds used for airports at sea level.